saw in a previous video that if a function has an absolute maximum or an absolute minimum, that those maximum or minimum values would be unique. But how do we know if they even exist or not? Because we saw some examples that they didn't exist. The extreme value theorem does come into play here, and it does give us conditions that will guarantee the existence of absolute maximum or absolute minimum values. That is, the extreme value theorem guarantees the existence of absolute extrema. So if a function f is continuous, remember, continuous means that the function is equal to its limit on all places in the domain. So if a function f is continuous on the closed interval a to b, so the closed interval means the points a and b are included inside of that interval, then this function will have an absolute maximum and an absolute minimum on that interval. And the basis of the idea comes from this. Let's draw like a continuous function. And thinking of the domain here, let's pick some value. We have a and we have b. And so let's look at these values. So we have some f of a, we have some f of b. And so if we look at those, we look at just this little strip here on the graph. So looking just between these two lines, is there a place where it gets the biggest or some place where it gets the smallest? And the answer is yes. The absolute largest value appears to be right here, where actually it's touching the line. And the minimum value is likewise going to be happening here as well. Maybe like right here is the absolute minimum. Turns out there's more than one point that obtains the absolute minimum value there. And so if you have a closed interval of a continuous function, then the extreme value theorem guarantees that you will have an absolute extrema, both a maximum and a minimum. Now, I should mention that the assumptions of the extreme value theorem are important. The reason we chose the assumptions the way we did is because if we relax any of the assumptions, then it could be a false statement then. So why is continuity important? Let's suppose we consider the function, let's just take it's a standard tangent function, y equals tangent of x, and let's take the open interval, negative pi halves to pi halves. I'll do continuity in just a second. So let's start with why does it matter it's a closed interval? Well, if you take an open interval, notice what happens on our graph, right? We get arbitrarily close to pi halves, but we never actually touch pi halves. And because that coincides with the vertical asymptote, the function gets bigger and bigger and bigger. It has no absolute maximum value. And because we can get arbitrarily close to negative pi halves, we get closer and closer to the asymptote. We're going to go off towards negative infinity. We see that there's no minimum value. There's no one number for which you can't get past, right? You can get closer and closer to infinity and negative infinity without bound. So if you have an open interval, you can basically squeeze in some type of very large behavior, like a vertical asymptote or whatever. It's necessary. We need to have that in. We need to have a closed interval to guarantee that we have absolute extrema. But also, we need it to be continuous. This is why I'm using this tangent example. Let's say we have a closed interval now. Let's go from 0 to pi, like here. That's a closed interval. We include 0. That's part of the domain. We include pi. That's part of the domain. But because we have a discontinuity, particularly in this case, a vertical asymptote at pi x equals pi halves, there's no absolute maximum because we can get arbitrarily close to infinity. There's no absolute minimum because we can get arbitrarily close to negative infinity. So the continuity assumption and the closed interval assumption are necessary in order to guarantee that we have absolute extrema on our function. So with the extreme value theorem in hand, we actually have a strategy for finding the absolute extrema for a function that's continuous on a closed interval. And so this is the stratagem that we're going to follow here. So if we're going to find an extreme value, we saw with Fermat's theorem that the extreme values occur in one of two places. They occur at critical numbers or they occur at endpoints. Now the endpoints are going to be pretty obvious. They're given to us, a and b. But the critical numbers of the function between a and b won't exactly be obvious, so we have to search for them. So the first thing we have to do is we have to find all of the critical numbers of f. And that typically requires, we're going to have to compute f prime of x. We have to calculate the first derivative because we have to identify where is the first derivative zero or where is it does not exist. I'm not saying f prime of x equals does not exist because you can't equal d and e because that means it doesn't exist. But we have to figure out where is the derivative equal to zero, horizontal tangent lines, or where might the derivative be undefined, if at all possible. So that finds us the critical numbers. We then evaluate the critical numbers. We figure out their y coordinates. we figure out the y-coordinates of the endpoints, and then amongst this list, if we look at the y-coordinates of the endpoints, the y-coordinates of the critical numbers, the very biggest y-coordinate would be the absolute maximum guaranteed by the extreme value theorem. And the very smallest value in that list would be the absolute minimum value guaranteed by the extreme value theorem. Let me show you an example of how this works. So let's consider the function f of x equals x to the 8/3 power minus 16x to the 2/3. And let's consider the interval negative 1 to 8. What are the absolute extrema of this function on that domain from negative 1 to 8? The extreme value theorem guarantees there is a solution here. We have a continuous function and we have a closed interval negative 1 to 8. So we have to identify what point should we be looking at. We first look at the derivative. So f prime of x, by the usual power rule, we're going to get 8/3 x, lower the power by 1. So we're going to subtract 1 from 8/3 or subtract 3/3 from 8/3. This is going to give us 5/3 minus 16 times 2/3. Lower the power by 1, we're going to get negative 1/3 right there. We have to identify when is this thing equal to 0 or when is it undefined. Okay. The best way to do this is to write this as a fraction. We're going to want to factor this thing. Is essentially what we need to do right now. So noticing some things we can do. 16 it factors as 8 times 2. So we can take out an 8. We can also take out a 1/3. So I'm going to take away the coefficient of the fraction, 8/3 there. That leaves behind x to the 5/3 minus, we're going to have a 4 times x to negative 1/3. When you're trying to factor out powers of x, especially when there are fractions here, the best principle here that I can mention is factor away the smallest power. So in this case, we're going to factor away a negative 1/3 power. The sign does matter here. We're factoring out a negative 1/3 power of x. So we get 8/3 times x to the negative 1/3. And we're going to multiply that by, well, what's left behind? Well, when you factor it is just division. But instead of throwing away your divisor at the end, you keep the factor. So we remember there's an x to the negative 1/3. But factoring just means divide it. So we have to take x to the 5/3 divided by x to the negative 1/3. Right? And then we get minus 4x to the negative 1/3 divided by x to the negative 1/3. Division and factoring the same thing. It's just you remember what you divided by when you factor. X to the negative 1/3 is going to cancel each other here. In terms of dividing by x to the negative 1/3, we're really just subtracting the exponent, which really, since it's a negative, we're adding the exponent. We end up with this 8x to the negative 1/3 over 3. Then we're going to get x to the 6/3 power minus 4, which 6/3, of course, is is just going to be the x squared there. So we end up with 8 times x squared minus 4. Notice how I didn't mention x to the negative 1/3 that time. Well, that's because if you have a negative exponent, that really could go in the denominator. So we get 3 times x to the 1/3. And then x squared minus 4, if I factor that as a difference of squares, I'm going to end up with 8 times x minus 2 times x plus 2. All over 3 times x to the 1/3. So you'll notice that I took my derivative, I factored it and wrote it as a fraction. Why does that matter? Because why factoring is important, because if we want the derivative to be 0, that happens when the numerator goes to 0. The only way that a fraction equals 0 is that the numerator goes to 0. And so the numerator going to 0 is going to determine for us where are the horizontal tangent lines of the function. On the other hand, what makes the denominator go to 0 will make the derivative undefined. So f prime of x is d and e. But with a fraction, if the derivative goes to 0, the denominator goes to 0, this will suggest that we have some type of vertical tangent, which, of course, the derivative is undefined at that location. So we have to figure out what makes the numerator go to 0, what makes the denominator go to 0. The numerator, since it's factored 8 times x minus 2 and x plus 2, we get the critical numbers of 2 and negative 2. And in the denominator, if the denominator goes to 0, 3x to the 1/3, that would suggest that x equals 0. So the derivative is undefined at x equals 0, and the derivative is 0 at 2 and negative 2. But all three of these numbers are our critical numbers right here. So these are our critical numbers. But one thing that's important to remember about critical numbers is the critical numbers need to be inside of the domain here, negative 1 to 8. Which you'll notice that 2 and 0 are between negative 1 and 8, but negative 2 is not. So we actually need to throw that number out because it's outside of our domain. It's infeasible. So it's whatever it does, doesn't matter. It has nothing to do with our problem. We have to throw it out. The function does have critical numbers outside of negative 1 and 8, but we only care about the extremum inside of the domain negative 1 to 8. The next thing we're going to do is we're going to develop a t-chart here, where on the left-hand side, we're going to put our critical numbers and boundary points for x. So that'll include all those boundary points and the critical numbers we found. So we get -1, which was the left boundary point. We get 0, which is a critical number. We get 2, which is a critical number. And we get 8, which was a boundary point. We need to list those. Then we're going to look at f of x on the right-hand side of our t-chart. So we're going to evaluate the function, not the derivative. We're going to evaluate the function at these values. So we have to look at f of -1, which, remember, our function was originally, that you can't see it on the screen now. Let me write it right here. So we're going to get x to the 8/3 power minus 16x to the 2/3, like so. And, you know, there are rational exponents. We could calculate these certainly, but you could use a calculator to help you if you need to. So we have -1 to the 8/3 power minus 16 times x, times -1, excuse me, to the -1/2 power. Taking the cube root of -1 is just -1. So you're going to get -1 to the 8th power, which is actually a positive 1. And then -1 squared is also going to be a positive 1. So you get 1 minus 16, which is equal to -15. That's a value here to remember. And so honestly, I'm going to simplify this table and just write down the negative 15, like so. But like I said, we're trying to plug in, we're putting these into the function f of x to the 8/3 minus 16x to the 2/3. Plugging in 0 is pretty easy. You're just going to get zeros everywhere, so that gives you a 0. 8's, of course, a nice choice because 8's a perfect cube. So when you plug in 8, f of 8 here, you're going to end up with 8 to the 8/3 minus 16 to the 8/3 to 2/3, excuse me. When you take the cube root of 8, you're going to get 2. So you get 2 to the 8th minus 16 times 2 to the square, like so. In the end, this will simplify because, I mean, 2 to the 8th, what is that going to be? That's 256. And then you're going to subtract from 256, 64. So you get 192. And then lastly, you have to do f of 2. Which again, this one doesn't, 2 is not a perfect cube like the other numbers were. So this one, you pretty much need to have your calculator to get a good approximation of what's going on here. But you're going to plug this number in here. And that's going to give you approximately -19.05 if I round it to 2 decimal places. So this here is just kind of like scratch work. Don't worry too much about it. Because that's just how we calculate these things. This table is what matters. When you look at the table, the very biggest value on the right side of the table will give you the absolute maximum. So you see this right here. We're looking at the y-coordinate here. This is the absolute maximum value of the graph. Because 192 is the biggest value you get, no one else is bigger, so that's going to be the absolute maximum. And the maximum occurs at x equals 8. The maximum value itself is 192. Where's the minimum value? The absolute minimum happens here at x equals 2. The absolute minimum value, the y-coordinate, is going to be -19.05, and it's obtained at x equals 2. So this is the nice thing about the extreme value theorem. When you combine that with Fermat's theorem, because the extreme value theorem says on a closed interval, you're guaranteed to have absolute maximum, absolute minimum values. And Fermat's theorem tells you that they have to be at endpoints or critical numbers. You'll notice that the absolute maximum occurred at a boundary point, x equals 8, and the minimum happened at a critical number, 2, which is where the derivative had a horizontal tangent line. And so this demonstrates how one can solve the so-called extreme value problem. If you want to find the extreme values on a continuous function on a closed interval, you calculate the critical numbers, plug those into the function, not the derivative, plug the critical numbers and the endpoints into the function, and then the biggest number, the biggest value present will be the absolute maximum, the smallest value will be the absolute minimum, and that's all there is to it.